Hello and welcome to the DFS Coach Talk Podcast. Today is Friday, March 20th. I am Joe Sarvati, affectionately known as Coach, and I am joined with the one and only GPP super stud of the NBA DFS world. That's Mr. Andrew Hansen. How are you today, Andrew?
Well, I'm doing all right, Coach. Thanks for asking. I'm kind of doing what you're doing. It's reminding myself that this is Friday. It's kind of hard to keep track of what day we're on. Yeah. So here we are, another day, another podcast. That's what we do.
We do, and we're going to stay positive. I mean, it's easy in this time frame to complain and about everything from how this has been handled to leadership to what's going on, et cetera, et cetera. But the bottom line is, you know what, that doesn't do anybody any good. And we want to stay positive. This podcast hopefully can be a fun little escape that you can jump to each day and prepare yourself to win a bunch of cash when DFS
that's
gets
fun.
Back. Yeah, that's a lot of fun.
We like that.
No doubt. And then, of course, this weekend, tomorrow and Sunday, Mr. Apatry is going to join me. So that's always a ton of a comic relief for me because I usually get to pick on him a little bit, make fun of him a little bit. He'll come up with a few unique sayings like his juice on the bone and everything. So, you know, you get a little bit of sports, you get a little bit of laughter in there. You know, what else can you ask for? I give him a hard time all the time, Andrew, man. He is just such an easy target. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, we love him, though.
he's great. Couple things. Well, first of all, we're starting a series where it's really going to be an informational scenario where we're going to work through the next four shows, really talking about how, as the pros with DFS Coach Talk, we prepare for a slate, specifically NBA. And, you know, we're going to go through that from today, sort of the steps that we initially take in our process. And Andrew and I'll share some of those with you today. Then, like I say, this weekend, Mike and I'll work on tomorrow, really breaking down the sites, the differences between DraftKings, FanDuel, Fantasy Draft, and Yahoo. Go through all of those and the importance of knowing how they score, etc. And then the two, I think, the biggest keys are Sunday with Mike talking about contest selection, because I do believe that is one of the top, if not the top biggest mistake that people do in DFS, is they get in the incorrect contest based on their bankroll and what they're trying to accomplish. And so we're really going to break that down and dissect it. So that understanding is there so that our members and then hopefully our listeners that are going to join us as well, we'll have a good sense of that going into, when everything launches back out. And then Andrew and I will finish up that with the bankroll management side of it, both from the cash side and the GPP side. You know, what are goals you can make? How do you want to do that? You know, being disciplined with it. We'll go through every single detail there, which I think will be a fantastic way to do it. So, and then we start our team by team breakdowns, and we're going to just do it from the bottom of the standings, reverse order in the East from worst to first and West worst to first. So that'll take us 15 days. We're going to do two teams a day, and we're going to have guest appearances by several of our wonderful staff, Leighton and Brett and Santino and Dawson and a little bit of everybody sharing their thoughts on these teams. We're going to be looking at the teams individually. Like the first day is Cavaliers and Hawks. They're the two worst records in the East. We're going to just go each team. We'll split the show basically in half with each team and just dig into all the things that are going to matter when they come back. Like who's been playing? What are the trends? You know, we don't know if it's going to go directly to the playoffs, which would eliminate some of these teams playing at all. But as Andrew believes, and I believe, they are going to try to at least create some revenue stream and some healing for communities to get out there and support their team with some type of, even if it's a 10-game remainder of the season. So I think we will have some format of time to bet on DFS NBA with all of the teams. So that's why we're going through each team. We're going to bring up guys that are injured, that, you know, this time frame of being off is going to help them. We're going to talk about the veterans, how they're going to be when they come back. Are they going to be at the same level? Because now they have shut down all of the facilities for all of the NBA teams. So nobody can go work out and scrimmage or play in any of the facilities, in any public place, in any gyms. You know, everything's shut down. So unless they have a court at home where they can do some serious workouts, they're going to get behind the curve. So we're going to talk about those pieces too, because that is going to affect some people. They're not going to be ready when they come back quite as well as they were when things shut down. So anyway, that's sort of the landscape of what we're going to do. That'll take us into the second week of April. And then, you know, who knows? That's a month from now. Almost, maybe we will have more direction or understanding of where we're going to go from there. So do you think, Andrew, this is the million-dollar question that everybody wants to know. Let's get your opinion on it.
Okay.
If you had to make a guess or surmise how this is going to play out, and I know you're not a fortune teller, although the way you put those simulation lineups together, I don't know, man. You're pretty good at that. I'm a little bit afraid that you beat me twice in a row, and I'm thinking about taking you on. If you sweep me three in a row, I'm going to quit right on the spot. I'll just tell you right now. But anyway, what is your feeling from the sports world? Because that's all we're dealing with right now. How do you think this is going to play out? When do you think we'll be able to play DFS basketball and baseball again?
I believe, as we sit here on March 20th, that we will be playing DFS on June 20th. So 3 months, April, May, June. I think that first recommendation from the CDC to limit gatherings of 10, when they put that in place, that stretched forward until May 11th. So yep. Even if that's extended another week or so, I think that gives us a month to have the players start to get back in shape, start to practice together, get everything organized, and then that gives you a week or two buffer as well. I think that's realistic right now, you know, because the biggest variable is, are we going to have some sort of a national lockdown?
Right. I
personally think that would improve the situation, minimize the damage, and it would be hard and difficult for all of us to deal with. But, you know, that might sort of
expedite
getting back towards the society that we used to know, the schedule that we used to know. So yeah. I still think that's the most likely outcome.
Okay. No, I think it's reasonable. And it's, you know, a lot of people are saying that as well. So it'll be, there's just so much to unwind in all this, though, you know, to figure it out. I agree with you. I think that time frame is realistic. I wish it was shorter. But I just think there are so many different things that have to take place. It'll be amazing to me, though, of DFS come August and September. I mean, are we really going to be in the heat of the baseball season, the NBA playoffs, and the NFL all coexisting, you know, for 3-4 months in a row? I mean, that's really what it's sort of looking like, you know?
I do. You know what I think August could be? August is going to be the heart of the Major League Baseball season, and every game is going to mean more because it's going to be a shortened season. It's going to be the NBA Finals. It's going to be NFL preseason. It's also going to be, you know, major golf season. They're going to have they're probably going to have the PGA Championship in May.
Yeah.
In August. So you're going to have all four of those sports just completely cranking.
Yeah. And, what about hockey?
Exactly. I almost forgot about hockey.
And so, how about the fact that a lot of those sports share the same arenas?
I know. That's going to certainly be one of the challenges, is getting things
scheduled
and played, because it is on a condensed schedule, so it's going to be even tougher.
Good Lord.
But yeah, it could be a real bonanza in August if this just sort of goes according to the plan we just outlined.
Yeah. For those that play, most people play multiple sports in DFS, by the way. I mean, there's been a study. It's more than 3/4 of the people, I think it's even almost 80%, play more than one DFS sport. So, you know, whichever favorites you have, I mean, it's going to be, usually it's spread out a little bit, but now it's going to be okay. So that makes this preparation to me, Andrew, even more important. Because when you're overwhelmed with everything, when it does come back, you know, having all of these notes and this strategy and everything we're going to talk about all set and ready to go, I think is a big advantage and can give you an edge when you're getting in these GPPs and in your cash games.
Absolutely. And anytime you have a process that you have figured out and it's down pat and you stick to it, then you become more efficient and more effective.
No doubt. Well, before we jump into the sort of the entire process and how we go about this, I want to remind everybody, DFSCoachTalk.com is where you want to go. That's where you can see all about our website that talks about everything that we offer, we bring forward. Right now, we're focused on the Major League Baseball, the NBA, and the NFL. And, you know, we have pros that are in our Discord at all times talking about that, talking strategy, discussing players. We have a fantastic community already, you know, even in the short time that we launched, some really good people that share some good information. It's a great place to hang out, talk sports, et cetera. So we also froze all of our memberships from the day that this all started, when Gobert tested positive that evening. We froze our memberships. So anybody that has a month or season long or, you know, week even, we froze them, and they'll pick back up when we can start playing DFS slates. We don't count any of this other baloney out there with League of Legends and all those things. Those don't matter to us, because we're playing the real deal here. We're not just doing it to gamble. We're doing it to have a great hobby, but make some money at it as well. So, you know, join us. Again, you're not on the clock. If you want to join us now, join in. You're not on the clock till we start back with sports. So it's a good distraction. You can also check us out on Twitter, at DFS Coach Talk, or you can reach me directly at Joe Sarvadi, JoeSarvadi. Andrew is at Language Olympic, and Mike is at Mike Apotria, MikeApotria. So reach out to us if you have comments, especially on these next four shows. You know, questions, comments, anything you want us to discuss on the shows, tweet us and we will include that in for sure. So remember, we're going to continue to do these podcasts, no question about it, 7 days a week. We're going to release them early afternoon every day, so you can, you know, definitely listen in, join in, keep preparing for the upcoming restart of sports. You can check us out anywhere podcasts are found. We're on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Podbean, iHeart, Spotify, and YouTube, amongst others. We do ask you take a second or two, since everybody has a little extra time on their hands right now. Rate, review, subscribe. It's important to, you know, give us that thumbs up. Hit the little bell button and subscribe, so then when we do post a new pod, it gives you an update so you can listen right in. And, you know, we have a giveaway also. We're going to do monthly a 1-month giveaway if you put 5 stars and a little comment in iTunes. All of that's important because we want to move up the list, because it makes a difference when people search, if they're looking for, you know, daily fantasy sports talk or something of that nature, will come up quicker. And we want to grow our family here. We, you know, our community, and there's no better way to do it than to jump on and listen in and share your thoughts, etc. So we are excited about it for sure. So let's jump into this, Andrew, and we want to talk about the process that we always discuss each day. I think I mention it almost every day because it's so important. Really, the 3-step process that we think that the members should follow to really get the most out of what we're doing here and give you the best chance to win. I'll say those 3 now, and then we're going to go through, Andrew and I, individually or together, if you will, of how we get to these 3 stages throughout each day when we're preparing, to give you a little more insight of the background and how we're doing it. And it always, you know, we always recommend that you listen to the podcast each day, because as you'll hear here in a few minutes here, there's a lot of preparation that goes in the night before, earlier that day, into that podcast. So a ton of the base of the foundation of building your lineup can come out of that podcast directly. The notation, coming up with your skeleton lineup, your holder lineup, whatever you want to call it, that can all come out of that initial podcast. Then throughout the afternoon, just staying in tune with us on Twitter, being in our Discord, and you get to hear all the different things that are happening within the league, who's hurt, you know, who's ruled out, who's on a minutes restriction, on and on and on. And that's obviously going to be a massive amount of news as people come out of this stoppage. And then the third piece, and the most important, is just really tuning into us on our Discord as a member, jumping in there. That last 30 minutes is condensed down to, okay, here's all the final news. We're going to be chatting in there, talking about it, any shifts, because it's a domino effect in this game. If one guy sits, you don't just plug in another guy of the same salary, because there's all kinds of things that happen. If a guy sits, it changes the defensive matchup. It changes the potential for maybe the total in that game. So it shifts game preference. It shifts, you know, minutes for other players as far as usage, on and on and on. So we're going to dig into all of that in, you know, those changes in that last 30 minutes. And then we're the only provider that I know of that is going to give you a full DraftKings and fantasy, FanDuel lineup that you can utilize. And, you know, we recommend, you know, we put a lot into these. I provide the cash, and Andrew and Mike, depending on which one is on that day, provides a GPP. And yes, we want you to use our symbol and jump in these contests. And, you know, with our icon or whatever you want to call that, you know, so we can avoid getting in each other's way, because some of us will have the same lineups. We'll put those in there. Or, you know, if you followed the process and you want to put in a secondary lineup or your own lineup with a pivot or two, based on everything that we went over throughout the day, that gives you the ability to do that as well. So, and we encourage that because, you know, we want everybody to be part of what's going on. So that's how it all sort of comes together. So let's go back to where we start this off from. For me, I start the night before. I do not go to bed that evening until I've looked over the initial schedule for the next day. And I know it sounds old school, but it's the one old school thing that I still do. I write down literally on a piece of paper the teams and you know, who's playing each other, the time of the games, and then get that all prepared for the next day. So I'm doing my first glance, couple of notes, like, you know, if I want to remember that TJ Warren is out that game, I'll make notes, get all that paperwork ready, you know, review sort of that evening's games so that I know what's going to occur you know, what to look for the next day. So that's how I start out my initial process. How about you, Andrew?
I do the exact same thing. So I guess we're both old school because I take out a piece of paper and I write down all the games that are coming up for that day. Sometimes I do this the night before. Sometimes I do this the morning of. But I write them all down in order with the game tip-off time off to the left.
Yep.
And that's very important because we play a lot on DraftKings. Anytime you're on a site with late swap, you have to know when these games are starting.
Absolutely.
Because as you're following the news throughout the night, you start to cross off, well, it's 8:05, so I've got all the news in on the 8 o'clock games. I don't have to worry about them. Well, what's happening at 8:30? What's happening at 9? What's happening at 10? So then you know when to go check the news again, 30 minutes before that next tip-off or next series of games, and then you can make any late swaps that you need to. So absolutely, the first thing I do is just write down the matchups and what time are the games starting.
That's right. So we're on the same page there. Then, you know, the next morning when I get up, the first thing I do is I go to the lines. And what I'll do on the pieces of paper that I wrote down the games, I'll put in, you know, Orlando's -6. The total is 217. And then I put the implied totals down, which are extremely important. You know, it may be 117 for one team, 100 for the other. So I do that for all games. That's my first real look at building my initial lineup is that morning when I have all the matchups, the times, and the spreads and the totals and the implied totals. That gives me, you know, if you've got a game that's 246, it's Houston versus Milwaukee, the 1 and 2 fastest paced teams in the league. You know, I'm going to put a little circle around that. If it's a game where I know, you know, it's Denver versus, you know, Chicago.
Charlotte.
Yeah, it's slow. You know, the pace isn't going to be there. You know, I make a little X by it to, you know, lessen the factor if I want to utilize that game. So that's my first steps in the morning. What are your first blush in the morning, man?
Okay, so that's interesting. You just described numbers 4 and 5 for me. So
okay.
I do those things, but there's a couple other things I do first. So let me list those, and I bet you do them as well. But we have a slightly different order there. So what I do after I write down the games and what time they're starting is then I go to the team offensive pace,
mm-hmm.
offensive efficiency, and defensive efficiency.
Yep.
I write those down for each team playing that night. Okay. Then, so I start to get a sense of, you know, is this going to be high scoring? What types of defenses do we have here, et cetera? Then I look at each team's schedule in terms of, are they on a back to back? Are they on the front end of a back to back?
Yeah.
Are they coming in with lots of rest? So and if they're on a back to back or the front end of a back to back, I write that down next to the game. Then I circle the games to stack myself before I even look at the lines in Vegas. So I put all those things into the equation of the feel for it. I mean, it's a mixture of science and art, really, if you think about it. I mean, like you said, if I know it's Houston, Milwaukee, then I'm probably going to circle that game. If it's Denver and Charlotte, I'm not going to. But and you can do that on feel after you've studied these variables for long enough, or you can kind of do it more systematically, mathematically by putting those rankings on your sheet of paper and looking at it and breaking it down yourself. Because what I want to do is I want to have that natural feel and basically know at a glance, is this a game I'm going to want to stack?
Right.
And so I make those decisions myself. I circle a game or two, depending on the matchup. Sometimes I don't circle any, but usually it's one or two that I'll circle as I think these are going to be likely high scoring, likely close games. And then my fifth step is to actually go check the lines in Vegas, check the over-under, and have that sort of confirm what I was looking at. And, you know, the whole – however you get there at that point,
right.
You know, what you and I have done is we've decided which games we want to target before we get into any of the other variables.
Exactly. And, you know, there's no magic bullet. You know, follow this exact process of the way – that you look at this, you know, statistics or whatever you utilize to build who you want to play. But, you know, it's whatever you're comfortable with and how you departmentalize it in your brain of how you look at it. For me, I want to, you know, before I'm influenced by any of the specific game statistics, I want to know the team matchups and what those totals are, so I can get an initial feel in my head. And then when I'll explain what I do now in this next process, and it's lengthy, but this allows me then to build the layers on to, okay, once I'm done with these like six or seven steps, then I can start seeing, it usually stands out like a sore thumb of the game or the team that you need to have a couple of guys, two or three guys from, if you really want to take something down. And it sort of builds itself, and then I just can pluck it from there. So what I do next, and this is the order I use, I do it exactly the same every day. I go to the pace, and you can go to ESPN.com. Hollinger puts out the pace of each team. It's updated live, real time. So whenever you look at it, it's updated. And I literally write in the pace of play for every team on that piece of paper, where they are. Then I go next to team defensive efficiency. It's the best tool that I've found that gives you a feel of how that team is going to try to control that pace and the pace that they're going to play at. And the reason I like that, and I do, if you follow us or members now, you know, when I tell the teams in our podcast, the only things that I mention are the things I just did. The totals, the who's, you know, favorite over under, the implied totals of each team, the pace of play, and the defensive team efficiency. That's what I share on each podcast each day, because that's really the basis. Because the defensive team efficiency takes a lot of different things into consideration that people don't really realize. But the formula to get to that number, it really takes a more approach of position by position and then combined as a team. And a lot of it is based on how many possessions the teams have, how fast they get the ball up in the shot clock. There's just a lot of analytics that go into that number. And it's a pretty true test. And that's, again, updated every day as well. I go to www.teamrankings.com. And I click NBA. Then I click stats. And then after that, it gives you defensive dash efficiency. And if you go there and update it, you have to update it every day so it refreshes on your screen, and it's going to give you that updated information. So that is a key factor of what I look at. So then I've got – that's my basis that I'm going to bring on to the podcast and go from there. Then I go into what I call a little bit of a combination of my secret sauce that I think has made me more effective and winning a higher percentage than most people in the industry. And I don't say that in a cocky manner. I'm just being honest with the, you know, numbers don't lie. So I go to ESPN Advanced Statistics, and I look at the defensive real plus minus. And that's in the Advanced Statistics with ESPN. You can look that up. And I want to see where there's a standout player playing a team. I've already sort of got a sense of who I like. Let's use an example of Donovan Mitchell, shooting guard for Denver. Let's say they're playing Utah. I want to know how Utah plays against shooting guards throughout this season. And the defense real plus minus is a good factor there. It's, you know, it's sometimes you think, is it exactly calculating the right information? And you know what? Sure, there's going to be some variance in there, but I'll tell you right now, it's as solid as you can get. Like if you go in there and look at we talked about this on one of the shows, we did the top five and bottom five of each defensive real plus minus. And of course, at the top, you had guys like Marcus Smart, Patrick Beverley, you know, all the shutdown guys. And at the bottom, you had the Trey Youngs and all those guys that we know don't. So, I mean, the numbers don't lie, and they come out there. And that allows me to hone in on usually about 10 guys that I think are in the most advantageous position to excel against a team that doesn't defend that position well. So I'll mark those down. But what I found, this is really interesting, Andrew, but what I found to be the biggest thing, and you'll, I think you can attest to this after doing all these shows, what it does is it calls out like 10 of what I call the trap or the sucker play guys. Because, you know, people will just immediately go to somebody like Harden, for example. But if it happens to be a team that has a slow pace that defends that position really, really well, and you know, et cetera, with the rest of these stats, then I put Harden on my do not take list. And sometimes those guys that I'll bring out, the traps and et cetera, are the differences more so than even picking out the good guys. Does that make sense, Andrew?
Absolutely. You avoid guys that you normally like to play because they're such high producers, but if they're in a bad spot, bad matchup, back-to-back, so many factors that go into it, but especially that defensive matchup and overall game pace, then that's when you have to fade the stars.
Exactly. And let's say on that slate, Harden is 65% ownership, and you fade him, and he only goes like 3x, 3.5x. Well, that gives you a massive jump on the rest of the field. So just identifying a few of those guys is all it takes. You know, you don't need a monster list. You get two or three that do that. I mean, it's a massive, massive difference. So that's a big part of it as well. So then once I do that, I like to go into I go to fantasypros.com. I go to Daily Fantasy. I go to the NBA, and then I go defensive versus position. And what this does is they break it down a little bit differently than just the real plus minus. It gives you a true ranking of the players as far as where they stand, both as players and as teams against the other team's opponents. So then in case, you know, the numbers are skewed because, let's say, you know, you're looking at Malik Beasley. He didn't play very much for Denver. He's playing a lot for Minnesota now. So those numbers aren't going to reflect the true full breadth of what his number should be now. So this gives you more of a in-depth one step beyond of really trying to identify those guys for sure. Then I know it gets a little crazy. I love to look at – I go to Fox Sports. I go to Stats Seasonal. And then I look at the advanced stats, and I look up up-to-date usage. And that's key, and I'll tell you why. Because, yes, we know Harden's, like, in the top three. He shoots the ball all the time. All the guys, you know, some of it you know. But what you don't know is, you know, maybe somebody like a Rudy Gobert is 19th on that list, and his usage is 28%, and he's going to be out that game. What it does is it allows you to look at where is that usage going, who else on the list for Utah is up in that high group, okay? Where does that mainly go? Donovan Mitchell, okay? He's already 32%. You know he's going to get a lift from Gobert, so you got some notations there. You know, let's look at like a Tony Bradley, who's Gobert's backup. You know, his... It, you know, you can follow through and see what his numbers are. He doesn't get a ton of that usage, but again, it's spread out over a period of time. So you make a notation of that. So it just gives you those usage numbers of, you know, everybody knows the Hardens, Westbrooks, Lucas, all that. But it's those guys from like 15 to 50 that really can shift with people being in or out of games. Or if they're a high usage player against a team like Houston, that's second fastest team in the league, then those it gives you a little, you put a little star by those guys. But then the true test, and this is my very favorite, I go, and if you don't use this site, then you're not going to win long-term in DFS. That's how much I feel this strongly about this in the NBA side of the world. It's basketball-reference.com. You go to advanced stats. You can look back at every game the teams have played in every different scenario throughout the season. So if you want to go back to Utah the last time Gobert didn't play, you can go to the advanced stats, look at the results, and it not only tells you some information, it gives you all of the information. So you can look at that game 2 months ago that Gobert missed and see exactly who played, exactly what the game flow was, the minutes played, the usage percentage. So let's say I go back to that game, and that's where I see that the backup center, where Tony is all of a sudden, he was 31% usage in that game. So he's minimum value. Is this a guy that you want to play when Gobert's out? Absolutely. There's one of your keys to the slate. Now, if it's a different thing, let's say Donovan Mitchell had been backed up by who's a backup guard for
Clarkson.
Okay, so you go back. Well, in that instance, Clarkson wasn't on the team yet. So you can't weigh it out as much because he got traded to them. Moutier. So you have to look right. So a Moutier, for example. Okay, so Moutier didn't move much. You know, he's a 4%, he went to 5%. So, you know, you don't want to play Moutier just because Mitchell's out. But you can go back to Basketball Reference and see, wow, Conley went from 17% usage to the game that Mitchell was out to 30. So there's your big leap of the guy that now is in play. A Mike Conley, who you normally wouldn't play in this scenario, is going against a fast-paced team. He's the biggest beneficiary of Donovan Mitchell being out, and that gives you a real true analysis of all of those numbers put into what that situation is. You can also, even not on an injury situation, let's say, you know, Houston plays Milwaukee. Okay, what am I going to do? I want to play Houston guys because this is the 1 and 2 fastest team, but I'm concerned to play Houston guys because Milwaukee's number one team in team defensive efficiency in the league. So let's go back to when they played last time. Who did it affect? Who didn't it affect? And you got to look, you know, if there's player personnel changes, you can almost replace guys. Like if there's a guy that blew out his knee, like the one guy did, and then House came into that spot, even though he's not in statistically in there, you can plug him in there because he, you know, that he's taking the minutes that the other guy that got hurt was playing. And you can see that, okay, Milwaukee has a tendency to give up a lot of threes, which is true. So let's look, who did it really change? It didn't help Westbrook when they played. It did shut him down a little bit because he doesn't count on the three, and they had Gobert and everybody inside to shut him down. So Westbrook's not the guy that did well. But let's see. Oh, my goodness. Ben McLemore was 27% that game. He got minutes. He gets wide open threes against Milwaukee. You know, I use Gobert, but I meant Brook Lopez. You know what I mean?
Right.
So and so then you can go in on a guy like, OK, is Ben McLemore in my player pool? Is he going to be a guy that's going to get enough minutes at a minimum price to go 7-8x? Because he did so well last time they played him, and, you know, you're seeing that they give up a lot of threes, et cetera. So I know this sounds like the minutia and the weeds, but it's not. It's pretty straightforward, and it's the differentiator to what makes the difference. So that's usually the progress of the steps that I take. So then when I come out of this, I don't listen to any other shows. I don't tune in to any of our competitors in any sense, because I don't want my thoughts skewed initially. I don't want to avoid a person because he's going to be super owned or be afraid to put a guy on there that's going to have 2% ownership. And our members will attest to it. You'll see my lineups and you'll have two or three guys, 1 or 2% owned sometimes, which is unusual. Almost every provider goes the safe route and provides the guys with a lot of uses. It's just the truth. So I go into that podcast with Andrew or Michael with all of that information so that I can speak to those guys in that essence of the pool. I haven't built my lineup yet, but I got my skeleton. I got my ideas. I know I'm looking a little bit at Macklemore. I know that I think, you know, Harden is a great play that day. I know I want to avoid Westbrook. I know I want to avoid Mitchell, whatever. I've got all that stuff down. I can talk about that a little bit on the show. And that brings me to that point. So it's a lot of stuff, Andrew. But how about you as far as right before we go into the show then?
Well, I want to just summarize what you've said in another way, which is that a lot of the stuff you're talking about, first of all, we do it so that if you don't have the time to do it as a listener, then you can take advantage of the research that we've done. Right. But another way to describe it is just the stuff that you get these questions in your mind when you're looking at a slate and you say to yourself, man, I'd like to know what that answer is. Like, what happened when Houston-Milwaukee played earlier in the season? Or what happens to Mike Conley's usage when Mitchell is out? And it's the stuff that you want to know, but do you have the energy and the time to go find it out? And so that is the key. I mean, that
right.
If you want to be your best, you got to go down those rabbit holes as much as possible.
That's the difference maker.
Yep.
It really is. That's the secret sauce of putting all of that information together. You're exactly right.
So to get from where we are so far to the podcast and building lineups, the other steps for me are after I've sort of built the slate, looked at the pace, offensive, defensive efficiency, looked at the schedule, looked at the Vegas lines, then you got to look at the injuries. You got to go wherever you are. You're the night before, you're in the morning, you're at lunch. Look at the injuries because that's obviously going to have a major effect on each game and the slate overall. So I do that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then I look at what you just mentioned, the previous matchup between those two teams this season. There's just a ton of information you can gather from previous matchups. How did this particular center do against Gobert? How did these point guards match up against each other? How did this guy respond to Chris Paul defense? Whatever the case may be, there's a lot you can take away from the previous matchups between those two teams. And then I also like to look at the box scores for each team from their last two games, usually, just to get a sense of recent trends in minutes. And this is something I've talked about before, but there's a lot of things you can take from a box score that you can't get anywhere else. And sometimes, you know, reading box scores gets a little bit of a negative connotation, but here's what I want to stress to our listeners, the value of looking at a box score. And you have to compare it to what you see on a fantasy site if you're looking at a player's performance. So if you just look at somebody's fantasy point total, that doesn't tell you how many minutes he played. Right. That doesn't tell you how many shots he took. Yep. It doesn't tell you how many three-pointers he took. And those are just three of the many variables I look at when I look at a box score. And the nice thing about doing it is you've got it all in one place so you can see how things work with each other. You know, if you look at a couple box scores and you haven't done it before with this in mind, you start to see, oh, so if Jokic plays 30 minutes, how many minutes did Plumlee play? 18. They don't play on the court together. So you can really learn a lot by looking at minutes played. Again, and then with the field goal attempts and three-point attempts, I don't want to know that he made four shots. I want to know if he was 4 for 6 or was he 4 for 18? Because, mm-hmm. again, if you're not following it closely, you're not sure. Maybe you haven't gone and looked at usage numbers.
Yeah.
But if you're looking at these numbers day in and day out, you know those things instinctively. You know who's getting all the shots. And yep. that's important because we want to get guys who are bouncing back. You know, maybe they only made 4 shots last game, but they took 18. All right, well, if he's going to get that percentage of the shots on offense, you know, maybe I want to get him here on a bounce back. And as I was preparing for our show today, I remembered a guy whose stats really jumped out at me this year at one point during the regular season, and it's LaMarcus Aldridge and his three-point shooting. So yeah. I want to break this down for our listeners. All right. When we think of LaMarcus Aldridge, we think of that guy in Portland and now San Antonio, who for years he's gotten the ball on the block, done a lot of damage in the post, and he's shot a ton of those mid-range jumpers.
Yeah,
and he's
maybe the best mid-range jumper of all time.
Yeah, and he's pretty good at it. But when we think of him in Portland, we don't think of him as shooting three-pointers, right?
No, never.
And so if you go to somewhere like Basketball Reference, you pull up his stats, all those years in Portland and in San Antonio, how many shots, how many three-pointers did he attempt per game? It was 0, 0.1, 0.3, 0.2, 0.3, 0.2, 0.2, 0.2, 1.5, 0.2, 0.8, 1.2, 0.5. So coming into this season, he'd only had one season in all those years where he took more than 1.2 three-pointers a game. So he is just not a three-point shooter, plain and simple.
Mm-hmm.
But that changed this year, all right? And if you're following the box scores, at some point you're going to notice that. So let's go through his game log this year of his three-point attempts. And he started off sort of like he had for his whole career. 1-3-1-1-3-1-1-1-0-0-1-3-5-1-2-0-2-3-1-1. Then he missed a couple games. So far, you know, it's nothing crazy. But then all of a sudden, that's where it changed. So from there on out, he's gone 2-2-3-3-2-1-5-2-6-3-4-7-3-5-9-6-6-3-4-4-4-2-2. And then the last 10 games, he's been up and down, but he's had two more games of 5, a game of 6, and a game of 8. And so that's where I think it's important, again, to look at each box score. These things start to pop out at you. I mean, if you catch him at the beginning of that trend, then all of a sudden you're going to be ahead of the curve. And maybe you know, after he'd had a 5, a 6, and a 7 over the course of a 7-game span, if you started investing in him at that point, then you were going to hit that stretch where he went 5, 9, 6, 6. And, oh, by the way, he was making a lot of these threes. And so the end result is that he now averages 3 3-point attempts per game this year. And a guy who, you know, he falls into so many categories, especially since he's on the Spurs now. And, you know, the Spurs box scores are so bland and blah. Yeah. It's easy to kind of just gloss over them. But this is just one more reason why I just want to stress to our listeners that's why you go back and look at box scores. And if you do it consistently, you're going to start to see these things pop out and you're going to get an edge.
I think that's a great point. And identifying those trends before everybody else does is a big plus. And it's funny you brought that one up, because I remember doing a show with you and you brought that point up. This was like maybe after he had attempted like 5, 5, and 3, and you had said, okay, you know, I'm looking to roster this guy because it seems like he's added this 3-point shot to his repertoire ever since he's come back from injury. And it paid off for you. And I think a lot of the industry hadn't caught on to that yet. So I think that's a great point. And that's stuff that really, you know, we want to do a lot of that for you to take that some of that hard work away, but it's certainly stuff that you can certainly track yourself and find out and beat people to the punch before they catch on. I wanted to mention two other things I do right before we go on air with the podcast is I look and mark down on my sheet, because I read those out during every podcast as well, who's on the first night of a back-to-back, the second night, and who's played like 3 games in 4 nights kind of stuff. That is very important information. And then that's where I finally look, because I try to wait till the last minute because the updates come out later and later with players. Then I'll go on and I'll look at Fantasy Labs and the places that give the updated injury report and mark all of those down. Because that also highlights, you know, if I've already done those other 6 steps and then all of a sudden Mitchell is questionable, now based on the defense he's facing, who stepped up in usage during that time, how those minutes allotment are going to work, if Mitchell's off the court, now all of a sudden Mike Conley's really a serious play for me. So that's why I look at it in those standards and those steps. Then we go on the podcast, we go over everything else. And then like everyone else throughout the afternoon, that's where I fine tune and build my lineup. Any other information that comes out, you know, I've already done the complete statistical brush of everything and I've gone through this, but here's the final piece. And this is why, you know, some of you out there may be saying, wow, coach just gave out exactly how he prepares for a lineup and for a slate. You know, why I'll just do these things and I don't really need to jump on with DFS Coach Talk. This is where the difference comes in. When I'm preparing those lineups and it's getting close to that 30 minutes before lock, the difference that I look at when I make these final decisions have to do with being just a huge basketball fan that watches a ton of basketball, understands how the game works, understands a little bit how the coaches think, and knows coaches' rotations, tendencies, etc. So that you can't really put on a statistical analysis, but I know those things. So I will start looking at these things like, you know, knowing Carlisle's use of his bench in a game 3 and 4 days where I know he's not going to extend Luka, where it's going to bring a guy like Jalen Brunson into play, because I know Carlisle's philosophy and thoughts, and I think this is going to be a close game based on the usage and how you know, the minutes are going to be split, etc. So I start putting all those pieces together. Whereas, let's say it's Houston, one of the common ones we always talk about. They're playing against Phoenix. They beat them bad the last time. It looks like they have the advantage here. We've looked at all the other things. Phoenix struggles with guys slicing to the basket, finishing based on usage and basketball reference on the last time they played. Westbrook just crushed them. They couldn't stop his penetration. And I know D'Antoni plays guys well into the fourth quarter with a 30-point lead. It's just his philosophy. He wants to have guys on the floor more. And, you know, then you look at the other little idiosyncrasies. You know, the Chris Clemens was sent down to the G League. He's not going to steal some of those late minutes. All those little pieces that you follow and know, but just by watching, you know, then in that instance, Westbrook becomes a stronger play, you know, where other people may eliminate him because they're a 14-point favorite. So knowing the game, watching the game, you know, the biggest advantage I've gotten, like there was a game earlier in the year where LeBron was playing, but I noticed, you know, like he was coughing a few times. He took a few plays off, which he hasn't done this season at all. And I was like, this guy, something is not right here. I'm crossing him off my list tomorrow. This was the day before. And no report came out. Nothing came out. They were a late game on the West Coast. I had already taken him off my sheet. He was 44% owned. An hour before the game, he was scratched due to being sick. So that's just eye test, man. You just got to watch it. You know, I watched a game where Golden State was playing. It seemed like meaningless. It was a 30-point difference. It was the beginning of the fourth quarter. He brought Marquese Chris into the game. Marquese Chris got smoked, allowed 2 dunks in a row, just wasn't engaged at all. And I saw Kerr's anger. He yanked him out of the game, not physically, but he took him out of the game. And I knew he was pissed. So I thought, you know, this guy is in the doghouse. I'm not rostering him tomorrow. It was a short slate, a 3-game slate, and everybody was jumping on Chris because he's going to start at center, but I didn't feel comfortable with it. Well, that just happened to be the game where he didn't get many minutes. They actually waived him the next day. He cleared waivers. Nobody picked him up. And then a week later, they ended up picking him back up. So they must have given him a second chance. But you can see some of those things coming just by that massive eye test that you're not going to see in any statistical analysis. And let's face it, a lot of the people in the industry, and I'm not saying this to be negative, God bless them all, they all do a great job. They're taking all the analytics and statistics, putting it into an optimizer. The optimizer is spitting it out and saying, play 150 lineups with 7% Conley and 9% Donovan Mitchell and 12% Luka on down the line. Now, if you're a mass entry person, which I don't think most people that can afford 150 $40 entries, I think maybe less than 1%. If you're the normal guys that are out there trying to, you know, play some cash games or get in some GPPs, single entries and stuff that are winnable, then you've got to do this by hand. I just don't see another way. And you got to use all those statistics. They're all important. They're a huge piece of weight. But then you have to have that other piece of knowledge. And that's why I'm not afraid anytime anybody asks me any questions, how do you do your research to prepare for a slate? I'm happy to share, like I did today, exactly how I do it. But that's about three quarters of the story. The part that makes the biggest difference, that other 25%, is understanding the game inside and out, understanding the players, the tendencies, the coaches, the rotations. And then, you know, you put all of that into play with the statistics, follow it closely throughout the day for any news, and then lock in that last 30 minutes to make sure that you have the best possible lineup. And that's when I look at usage, or I'm sorry, ownership. Not until then. I want to know at that point who is getting over-owned or under-owned. You do need to look at ownership when before you put your last lineup together, because it can be a differentiator. If you like two guys like almost the same through all this stuff, it's still down to two guys, and a guy is 60% owned and a guy is 20% owned, which guy are you going to go with? You're going to go with the 20% owned guy because you like him equally. You want an edge on the field. Now, sometimes there's a guy on a small slate that happens a lot, like Luke is in there. Okay, he's 86% owned. But it is what it is. You got to eat the chalk. You got to play him. He turns out best on all your studying. You can't just fade a guy just because of ownership. But you have to understand then, okay, I have Luka like 86% of the world does. So let's look at another spot to differentiate, you know, slightly. And I play cash games. So I'm not going to take wild shots. You know, the GPP guys, you can take a little bit more of a differentiating slot. I want to be different than some guys, but it's not in lieu of taking such a wild shot that a guy that averages 10 fantasy points a game, you're trying to get 30 out of. So you got to, the balance in cash is, you know, look at the ownership, let it have some effect on your final lineup, but don't let it dominate it. And then, you know, don't be afraid to back off of that low percentage guy. If through all that research, I found Mike Conley to be the guy that night and he's 3% owned, I'm not going to let that shake me off him because I have the basis to do that. So I will play him in cash. Now, maybe Tony Bradley, the backup for Gobert in that whole mix that we sort of talked about, I wouldn't have, you know, the guts to put him in my cash lineups, but I would definitely utilize him in a GPP because he could come in at the low price dollar and get 35 fantasy points, and then you're that step ahead. So that's sort of the picture. That's how I come up with my final product, Andrew.
Yeah, that's a lot of great stuff, and I love how you broke down some of the things you do at the end and where that edge comes from. And it's funny, all these variables we've talked about, we haven't mentioned two really big ones. You certainly hit on it, but it's the eye test that comes from watching the games. And that's something we pride ourselves on. We do it and we love it, and you get so much out of it. Like whether it's LeBron looking like he maybe is a little bit under the weather, and then you plan to fade him. You mentioned Chris Clemens. He's a guy I've talked about a lot this year, and that's from watching him in college, watching him in preseason, and knowing what kind of game he is and what's he like when he's on the court. He jacks up threes as soon as he gets over half court. I mean, he's shooting like he's Trae Young, and he's got a great shooting form. And so that's why if you know that, you've studied, you've scouted, you on the eye test, you know what to expect from somebody like that, then you have a much, you get an edge because you have a strong opinion on, well, once he gets his shot, I'm going to play him. And so I still remember one of the best nights I had this year was that game when Houston was traveling to New Orleans. And Harden, Westbrook, and Capella all sat. And I went all in on Clemens and Hartenstein and had a terrific night. Just smashed with those lineups because other folks, you know, maybe they played one of them. But nobody, not many people were going all in on both of them. So
Right.
That's certainly what the eye test is for and all the scouting that we do. And then the other thing I got to mention, which is funny, this whole podcast about preparation, the one thing we haven't really talked about at all is the player pricing. You know, what is the pricing on that night for each player?
Yeah.
And for me, one of the most fun things to do is we do all this research ahead of time. And then at the very end, if you actually look at the pricing on each site, then guys really jump out at you and you say, well, what in the world is this guy priced at 4,500 for on DraftKings? Or why is this, you know, stud at, you know, 7,700 instead of 9K? And, you know, then you, that's when you really start to, you know, work on roster construction for that night is everything that goes into it. And then you make adjustments based on the price.
Yeah.
And that's just what I think is really a lot of fun.
It is. And that's a good point. You know, that I sort of, it's not part of like my build for my lineup. It's weird. The salaries come into play once I have my player pool and I'm ready to roster my team. Then I have to look, you know, that's where you'll find, and it's been weird this year, you know, DraftKings and FanDuel, you have a guy 7,500 on one site and 5,700 on the other site. It's like nuts. So you have to take advantage of those price breaks. But, you know, I don't let that completely dictate. Sometimes you can get fall into that, well, I'm just taking him because he's a value. Well, not if he doesn't fit all the other criteria that we've discussed for the last hour. I mean, if he fits that criteria and he's a value, then yes, absolutely. But, you know, I still want to let my research dictate my lineup more than the pricing dictate. Because I think a lot of people go in and they build their lineups on price. They'll look at, all right, who are the cheap guys I can get in here at value so then I can buy the Hardens and Lucas. And you know, that's fine, but it's not getting to the bottom. You're cutting all that middle part out that prepares it. For me, I've got my player pool. I'm going to look at the pricing. Can I afford, you know, these three guys? No, I can afford two of them. So let's look at who's left in that player pool at the cost that can make it fit. And then the fact that a lot of times, Andrew, I'll play all four sites. I'll have a lineup or two, because I only play one or two lineups a night, but I'll have it on DraftKings, FanDuel, and I'll also throw some in Fantasy Draft and Yahoo. So if you have that player pool and you can put them in, you know, just need to really organize them by salary at that point and get them in there, it makes it much easier when it comes down to crunch time. But yeah, salary is a piece, and that's part of, you know, what we like to, you know, you have to have some pivots in mind for different sites that have different pricing. Plus, we'll talk about on one of these other shows here coming up shortly is how do the stats count? You know, so you get a bonus for a double-double on some sites. You get extra for three-pointers on some sites. That all comes into play. And you can't willy-nilly just play the same lineup on every site. That's a death sentence right there. You have to let the site and the pricing and how they do their scoring dictate the lineup. So this is not a process. You know, if you're putting money into this and you're looking to be profitable, this isn't something that you can just do in 30 minutes. I mean, and I think you personally, you know, come to us at DFS Coach Talk. I mean, you know, what we've stated in this show alone will tell you how hard we work at this, how much we believe in it. And we don't win 75% of the time by accident. We do it because we follow all of this very, very religiously when we prepare for every slate. Whether it's a 3-game or a 14-game, we're doing the same steps to prepare. So take advantage of us with DFS Coach Talk. Utilize a different approach than you're going to find from anybody in the industry. I guarantee you that. I've done all the research, been through them all, checked them all out, been part of some of them. And what I wanted to do was take an overall look, get some of the most respected people in the industry together and create something that's completely unique that can shift the needle in DFS. And I think that's what we have here at Coach Talk. So, you know, we look forward when sports gets back for everybody to jump on and enjoy it with us.
Yeah, absolutely. If y'all like what you're hearing, if you're sort of new, you're checking us out, then come join as a member. Like Coach said, basically your account will be frozen. So all this downtime we have, we're chatting in Discord with our members. I don't know if you can hear it on my computer, but I've got all these notifications coming up with our pros and our members chatting even throughout the afternoon here. So we're constantly interacting to share information, and it's fun, you know, and there's nothing like a little community of like-minded people to help get you through this rough period. So,
yeah,
you know, feel free to come and join as a member now, and your account will be frozen, and you can interact with us in our member Discord area, chatting and sharing information and getting through it. And then we'll be ready to rock and roll, hopefully by June. Really, that's my over-under. My over-under would probably be about June 15th. And so I'm going to go over it with the June 20th start.
Gotcha.
But to be honest, anything in June right now, I would take. So that's what we're gearing up for.
Well, I'm gonna be the eternal optimist and say May 15th.
Oh, nice. I like it.
I know there's no criteria to that. It's just the power of positive thinking. If we all think May 15th, maybe it comes true. You never know. Well, awesome, man. We've gone pretty long on this show. I knew these next four shows were going to go long, but you know, we want to share it, you know, give you a chance to really dig in, listen to all this stuff at a different level. And, you know, hopefully it's extremely helpful for you. And I enjoy being able to share it. Obviously you can tell we're very passionate here about it. So, we're excited to share all of this with you. Now, tomorrow and Sunday, like I say, I'll be with Mike Apatria. We're going to do the shows in the morning, so they'll come out a little bit earlier. On the weekends, we usually do that. Tomorrow is DFS Sites, DK FanDuel, Fantasy Draft, and Yahoo, sort of the differences, how they, you know, what the scoring systems are, etc. Then on Sunday, it's that contest selection. That's going to be a big show, because it's so important. You know, nothing drives me more crazy than when somebody's trying to build a bankroll. And I think I've said this a lot of times, but I got to say it one more time, is, you know, they'll tell me, okay, I'm only playing about $15 a night. I put two entries in the $7.77 super GPP on FanDuel, which is so hard to cash. I mean, and there's everybody roaring 150 lineups in there. I mean, you can't approach stuff like that. It's just not smart. So we want to go through, and a lot of people do it. I mean, it's they figure, hey, I'm going for it. I mean, they're going to win $100,000 or not win anything, you know, 100,000 times out of a 999,000, you know. So the bottom line is, you know, we're going to go over that, talk about it, figure out how, you know, to recommend. You know, also there's a lot of other idiosyncrasies that we have to just bring up that are important. And I want to mention one right now so I don't forget it on the next show. Don't ever play guys because their game is a national TV game or you're looking for a late night sweat game. If you're just doing that to do that for that purpose, you're going to lose. You cannot let any of that information affect your picks. One, I mark the times down on my sheet, not because I want to know when my guys are playing, because I don't care. I completely don't care if my entire roster is in the first game or the last game. That's how you have to approach it. I put them down for the late swap sites, which we'll talk about tomorrow, so that if there is a late change, then you know that you can make a move. But, you know, the simple things like that, if you get real disciplined, you know, we've got this time off, study these, write like your own personal top 10 down. I am not going to play just national TV games, a guy what I like, another guy a little better, but I'm going to play this guy because he's on national TV. Put all those little things down just to remind yourself, because you'll see a big change just with the small differences. Let us do the in-depth work of going into all those sites, looking at all the other stuff, then utilize our knowledge in that area with some of the things that you want to trend in doing the right way. So that's sort of where we're at, my man.
Absolutely. Yeah, it was a lot of fun today. I will be off this weekend, as you said, so have fun with Mike, and I'll be back on with you on Monday.
All right. Keep social distancing this weekend.
Yes, indeed.
I think, you know, I got to scorn our lovely, we may have some listeners down there, so I apologize if I offend you. But if you're partying on the beach with thousands of people right now, get your ass home. Let's get through this thing so we can get back to sports. Listen to what the government's telling you. It's, you know, we got to just sort of chill for a bit and then we'll get back. Maybe if we all did that and squashed this thing, maybe my May 15th date can come true. You know, it's possible. So do it, do it, do it. Hey, real quickly, mambaon3.org, mambaonthree.org. Definitely jump on there. It's a great fund for those survivors from the whole Kobe thing. And, you know, those families need that support, especially now with the corona and everything going on. Just a fantastic site to go to if you want to share with that group. So, all right, that's it. Great show, Andrew. Fantastic info. Appreciate your insight. And, you know, hopefully this is something that our members and our future members will be able to use going forward. So any last thoughts, my man?
That's it. Thank you all for joining us.
Beautiful. Well, we thank you for joining us for this episode of DFS Coach Talk. For my fellow NBA pros, Micah Patria and Andrew Hansen, I am Coach. We will catch you again tomorrow as we look to prepare to crush it in NBA DFS.
The way to dribble up and down the court, just like I'm the king on the microphone. So it's Dr. J and Moses Malone. I like slam dunks and taking it to the hoop. My favorite play is the